So hello and welcome to the fourth and last day of this marathon conference. Really, really long and very rich and exciting and exhausting. I think this all applies to this event. So welcome, and our first lecture keynote here is going to be Ta-Nehisi Otabe. I tried to pronounce his name as close as possible. And he's coming from the University of Tokyo. He's a former president of the Japanese Society of Aesthetics. And he's a well-known authority on European aesthetics in Japan and elsewhere. So please, Ta-Nehisi, come and Professor Ta-Nehisi, the floor is over there, yours. Thank you.
Thank you for your kind introduction. I thank the organizer of this wonderful Congress, and it is my great honor that I can celebrate the 30th anniversary of the book with the author. So I wear the braces in my teeth since 3 weeks, and I have not yet accustomed to them, so apologize for my unclear pronunciation. And I brought my handout, so at the entrance there are several printouts. Schusterman's Pragmatist Aesthetics, published in 1992, does not directly address philosophy or aesthetics in East Asia. In retrospect, it is an appeal to East Asian researchers of Western-style philosophical aesthetics, including myself, to transform their style of thinking. This became even clearer when the second edition was published in the year 2000. In this book, the author added a new chapter entitled Soma Aesthetics, a Disciplinary Proposal, in which he cites Asian practices of Hatha Yoga, Zen meditation, and Tai Chi Chuan as examples of somatic training. He also refers to Yasuo Yuasa's The Body Toward an Eastern Mind-Body Theory. As the author himself admits, the discipline of Soma aesthetics is certainly prefigured in the first edition. However, the new name for some old ways of thinking clearly defined the project of somatic philosophy that he envisaged. In fact, quote, new names can be helpful both in stimulating new thinking and reorganizing and reanimating older insights, unquote. The potential of pragmatist aesthetics or even Soma aesthetics in the East Asian cultural sphere was later touched upon by Schusterman himself. Inspired by his insights, I will focus on one outstanding Japanese figure of the late 19th and early 20th century to clarify the scope of pragmatist aesthetics or Soma aesthetics in the globalized era. Except for the activities of the Jesuit missionaries from the late 16th century onward, Western philosophy was introduced into the East Asian cultural sphere during the second half of the 19th century. In 1868, the symbolic event of Meiji Restoration took place in Japan. Later, in 1877, the modern government-run University of Tokyo was founded. The so-called hired foreigners from Europe and the United States were invited to teach modern Western disciplines at the university. Western-style philosophy was also introduced as part of the modernization or Westernization of academics. During the same period, Western-style art, that is high art, and aesthetics were introduced as a discipline in Japan. Thus, the modern Western academic and artistic system paved the way for the reorganization of the academic and artistic tradition in Japan. not so much in ways that revitalize traditional Japanese culture, but rather in ways that distinguishes or even excluded Japan from modern Western academic and artistic system as pre-modern. This is because traditional Japanese thought was strongly characterized by practical wisdom, and the traditional Japanese artistic practices tended to be inspired, inseparably linked to daily life in such a way that they did not fit into the modern Western academic and artistic regimes. In this presentation, I will focus on The Book of Tea, published in English in 1906 by Kakuzo Okakura, pseudonym Tenshin. Okakura studied philosophy at the University of Tokyo as an inaugural student. He took advantage of his fluency in English to engage in art administration together with his teacher, Ernest F. Fenollosa. Okakura traveled to Europe and the United States with Fenollosa from 1886 to 87 to prepare for the establishment of the Tokyo School of Fine Arts, which was the first national art university in the modern sense. He dedicated himself to the preservation of Japanese antique art, which was in danger of disappearing into oblivion due to Japan's rapid westernization. During 1901 and 1902, he visited India and got acquainted with Rabindranath Tagore. In 1910, he was appointed as the head of the newly established Department of Chinese and Japanese Art at the Museum of Fine Arts, Boston. Okakura is rarely treated as a philosopher because of his prowess in art. I will skip over next sentence. The ideals of the East, the awakening of Japan, and the Book of Tea are his major works in English. However, these are rarely considered as works in philosophy. I'll skip to the next paragraph. Such a negative evaluation of Okakura suggests, however, that the axis of evaluation itself is inappropriate. The philosophical thought propounded by Okakura in the Book of Tea is based on the Taoist idea of Dao, which literally means the way or the path. The work construes the concept of Dao in Japanese, Do in Sino-Japanese reading, and Michi according to the Japanese reading from a pragmatic perspective in the wide sense of the word. One, several of you may probably heard the word judo or even seen the sport. Judo, formerly known as jujutsu, is a type of wrestling of Japanese origin. The word judo is composed of ju and do, where do literally means the way. When then does ju mean? Although judo is a competition that tests the strength of the competitors, ju paradoxically implies tender or gentle. In the Book of Tea, Okakura describes judo as follows. These Taoist ideas of vacuum have greatly influenced all our theories of action, even to those of fencing and wrestling. Jujutsu, the Japanese art of self-defense, owes its name to a passage in the Dao De Jin. In jujutsu, namely judo, one seeks to draw out and exhaust the enemy's strength by non-resistance, vacuum, while conserving one's own strength for victory in the final struggle. Unquote. Okakura probably has in mind section 78 of Dao De Jin. The translation by Paul Keras he refers to is as follows, quote, In the world, nothing is tender and more delicate than water. In attacking the hard and the strong, nothing will surpass it. The weak conquer the strong, the tender conquer the rigid, unquote. At issue is the paradox that something like water, which does not have a certain form by itself and appears weak at first glance, is in fact strong. The term judo offers an example of the Taoist thought that favors paradoxical expressions. The word ju offers the insight that one cannot defeat an opponent by relying only on one's own power. In other words, in order to defeat an opponent, one should not resist the opponent's power, but rather utilize it effectively. In Japan, martial arts such as judo and performing arts such as no theater are categorized as do. Traditional Japanese artistic practices such as calligraphy, painting, poetry, tea ceremonies, and so on are collectively known as geido. The literal translation of the word would be the way of art. These practices can be distinguished from the artistic regimes of modern Western origin. This terminology originated in the first half of the 15th century, became popular during the Edo period, and was established during the end of the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th century. Although the word Do is of Chinese origin, this terminology, way of art, is not popular in China. We will trace the development of the concept of Do that is peculiar to Japan. The word Do in Japanese, or Dao in Chinese, literally means way or path, and thus corresponds to the classical Greek word Hodos. All these three words are extremely polysemous, but I will simplify them to depict their characteristics. In ancient Greece, Hodos often takes the form of a contrast between two paths. In Hesiod's Works and Days, the road to badness is contrasted with the road that leads to goodness. Moreover, in Xenophon's Memorabilia, Socrates refers to the parable of Hercules at the crossroads. The question that is raised here pertains to which path to take, namely the path of virtue or path of vice. This suggests that for us, Hodos is an object of choice. Second, when Hodos is used in the dative Hodo or in the form Katahodon, it means methodologically. The following is an expert from Plato's Sophist. Quote, "So now this is my advice to ourselves, since we think the family of Sophists is troublesome and hard to catch, that we first practice the method of hunting in something easier, unless you perhaps have some simpler ways to suggest. The English translation does not show the connection between the words. However, the Greek words for way and methods are hodos and methodos. The word methodos is composed of meta and hodos. Put in order, the way becomes a method. In contrast, Dao appears frequently in Analects, one of the central texts of Confucianism, and here is a typical example. Quote, "The gentleman devotes his efforts to the roots. For once the roots are established, the way will grow therefrom. Being good as a son and obedient as a young man is perhaps the root," that is a typographical error, "a root of my man's character," unquote. According to Confucianism, Dao is a social order that arises from a fundamental virtue. Analects raises the question whether the way prevails in state or not. In contrast, according to the Taoist thought, the way takes a metaphysical connotation. The Dao produces one. One produces two. Two produces three. Three produces all things. Unquote. Taoist thought suggests that Tao precedes even the One and is the source from which all things, including human beings and their workings, transpire. This view contrasts sharply with that in Analects, where Tao is regarded as a social order derived from a fundamental virtue. Thus, the Tao in Taoist thought is formulated as follows. Quote, what is above form is called the way. What is under form is called an object. Unquote. The Taoist idea of Tao is characterized in terms of the relationship between the metaphysical and the physical, that which produces and that which is produced. It is against this background that Bodhi, that is awakened intellect, was later translated as Tao when Buddhism was introduced in China. Now let us probe into Tao in Japan. Initially, under the strong influence of Chinese political and scientific system, the concept of Tao was used to refer to a territory or specialized area. For example, the area out of the capital was divided into seven regions called seven Tao's, and the former imperial university established in 9th century consisted of four departments called four Tao's that can be likened to the liberal arts in Europe. The word Michi, a Japanese reading of Tao, was also used as the way of something, added to the word that designates various fields of sciences and arts, indicating individual areas of specialization. Towards the end of the 12th century, an example of Uta no Michi, literally the way of poetry, came into existence. Neither the term Tao nor Michi has been found to be limited to the academic or artistic activities. In Essay in Idleness, written in the first half of the 14th century, the term Michi refers to the various activities that people engage in their daily lives, such as the game of backgammon and the art of water wheel making. The author, Yoshida Kenko, who was impressed with the words of an expert backgammon player, states as follows, quote, this is the teaching of those who know the way of backgammon play. The same holds true also of the way of conducting the self and governing the state, unquote. Although each way marks a specialized area, a person who is familiar with a particular way is regarded as being familiar with the rest of the ways as well. This is because although the specific knowledge and skills involved in each specialized area or way may differ, there exists a common attitude in the pursuit of each of the ways. The awareness of the way is combined with the self-reflection on whether one has attained the way or not, thereby giving rise to the conception of the way as a physical mental training. In Buddhism, Tao originally meant Bodhi, awakened intellect, but in Japan, the word Buddhist Tao has come to mean the path of physical mental practice and training leading to an awakening. In sum, Tao in Japan is characterized by the perception that each activity of life is physical mental practice and training. Three. Let us return to Okakura's The Book of Tea. Okakura explains the Tao as follows, quote, the Tao literally means a path. It means it has been severally translated as the way, the absolute, the law, nature, supreme reason, the mode. The Tao is in a passage rather than the path. The Tao might be spoken of as great transition, unquote. Okakura owes a great deal to Paulo Coelho's 1898 translation of Tao Te Ching. However, his understanding of Tao deviates from that of Keras, who paraphrases the term Tao as follows, quote, it means path way, method, or mode of doing a thing, then also the mode of expressing a thing or word. And thus, finally, it acquired its main meaning, which is reason, unquote. Although Keras, in his translation of Dao De Jing, renders Dao into English as reason with a capital R, Okakura not only avoids the term reason, but also disapproves of the literal translation with the term path. Instead, he proposes the term passage, certainly not in the static physical sense, but rather in the active pragmatic sense of passing through. Here we find reflected the concept of Do peculiar to Japan, a concept not used as such, but added to the words that designate various fields of sciences and arts with the connotation of physical mental training. Thus, for Okakura, the concept of Do underlies what he understands as aesthetics. Quote, "The chief contribution of Taoism to Asiatic life has been in the realm of aesthetics. Chinese historians have always spoken of Taoism as the art of being in the world, for it deals with the present, ourselves. The present is the moving infinity, the legitimate sphere of the relative. Relativity seeks adjustment. Adjustment is art. The art of life lies in a constant readjustment to our surroundings. Taoism accepts the mundane as it is, and, unlike the Confucians and the Buddhists, it tries to find beauty in our world of woe and worry." By the way, this odd expression, being in the world, was translated into German as das in der Welt sein. And Heidegger possessed the German translation of Okakura's Book of Tea, so that was given, presented by a Japanese scholar. And Heidegger borrowed his famous expression, das in der Welt sein, from this Okakura's book. To accept the mundane as it is, means to affirm the world of woe and worry, that is, the imperfect. It does not, however, mean preserving the status quo, but rather finding beauty in the imperfect, a transvaluation of a value. In the world we live in, there is no absolute, and everything is relative, and we need to constantly readjust ourselves to the world of which we are constitutive, so that our conduct may align with that of others. Adjustment, therefore, consists both in a centrifugal moment of being engaged in and transforming the world, and in a centripetal moment of transforming ourselves through engagement with the world. These two moments of adjustment move cyclically, forming a never-ending process. Herein consists the art of life. At issue is, therefore, quote, "the process, not the deed, the completing, not the completion," unquote. Okakura insists that Taoist art of living forms the spiritual background of Chado, a literally the way of tea, for which he coins the term theism to draw attention to its kinship with Taoism and Zenism. In the tea ceremony, the host entertains the guests by serving tea. The ceremony consists of drinking, talking, and appreciating the various works of art, such as calligraphic works, painting, and so on, displaying in the tea room. Most components of the tea ceremony are part of daily life. How does Chado, namely tea ceremony, stand out from other daily activities? Okakura defines theism as a religion of art of life. That is, in theism, people consciously practice the art of life, thereby aiming for higher ideals. Quote, "The tea ceremony was an improvised drama whose plot was woven about the tea, the flowers, and the paintings. not the color to disturb the tone of the room, not the sound to mar the rhythm of things, not the gesture to obtrude on the harmony, not the word to break the unity of the surroundings, all movements to be performed simply and naturally. Such were the aims of the tea ceremony, unquote. Okakura regards the tea ceremony as a spontaneous performance by the host and guests in a small tea house specially designed for the ceremony. Every action in the tea house has certainly in its roots in the daily life activities. In everyday life, most of our actions arise first from inertia. The present is therefore an extension of the past, eroded by the past, so to speak. Second, our action is embedded in the means-end relationship and determined in advance by the end to be achieved in the future. Thus, the present has lost its meaning as the present. In contrast, I quote, the art of being in the world deals with the present, unquote, in a tea ceremony where even least action must be done absolutely perfectly. We must focus on the present that is neither an extension of the past nor the means to the future end. Therefore, every action takes on a completely different perspective. Quote, the whole idea of the theism or the result of this then conception of greatness in the smallest incidents of life, unquote. Okakura cites the example of caretaking of Zen monastery. Beginners are assigned the simplest tasks, whereas the senior monks are assigned the most difficult and servile tasks. Monks may also be required to participate in Zen discussions while doing their daily work, such as weeding the garden, cutting beets, or serving tea. Quote, such services form the part of the Zen discipline. Unquote. Similarly, in theism, people perform each small deed with extreme care in order to show its significance. Further, the tea house is, quote, consecrated to the worship of the imperfect, purposely leaving something unfinished for the play of the imagination to complete, unquote. To worship the imperfect does not mean being content with the imperfect as it is, but rather realizing its potential and thereby completing it. In the face of the imperfect, the host and guests cooperatively and extemporaneously conduct the tea ceremony as a performance in a small tea house. Thus, nothing other than perfecting the process of performance counts. For the tea master, the motto is, quote, perfection is everywhere if we only choose to recognize it, unquote. Thus, theism, which is rooted in daily activities, is not subordinate to life. On the contrary, it can affect it. Quote, the tea masters sought to regulate their daily life by the high standards of refinement which obtained in the tea room. Therefore, daily life enriches us with materials, and the art of life enhances them so that there exists a circular relationship between them. Thus, Okakura argued that, quote, the influence of the tea masters in the field of art is as nothing compared to that which they have exerted on the conduct of life, unquote. In Chado, everything that is not only tea utensils in alcove decoration, but also our every action is oriented toward finding beauty in the world. Okakura's view greatly resonated with the intellectuals. For example, Stemi Horiguchi, an architect and architectural historian, who sought to an original style that combined modern design and Japanese tea houses, characterizes Chado as an art of constructing life. Furthermore, Yoshinori Onishi, one of the leading figures in the aesthetics in the first half of the last century, claims that shadow can be compared to what the early German romantics termed Lebenskunst, art of life. In modern Japanese aesthetics, shadow has a unique position in art as the art of life par excellence. Four. In 1910, 4 years after publishing the Book of Tea, Okakura gave an influential lecture titled A History of Art in the East at the University of Tokyo. Okakura concluded his lecture with the following words, quote, "The great aspect of Japanese art consists in that art is life. There is a perfect harmony between art and social life. Even if you go to the countryside, there are flowers in the alcove, and even if you sit down in a room, there are manners. Everything in life is art," unquote. Calligraphic works and paintings are displayed in the alcove, and poetry is composed and recited in a social gathering. Thus, the traditional Japanese artistic practice is rooted in daily life and differs in this respect from modern conception of Western fine art. It was Okakura's teacher, Fenollosa, who directed his attention to this aspect. Fenollosa particularly underlined the fact that in Japan, there is no distinction between pure art and applied art. Quote, "People in the East did not find a theoretical distinction between fine art and decorative art necessary because they thought, unlike the Western people, that both are of applied nature, serviceable for decoration and used for making life beautiful, and they did not forget that decoration is a noble art. Therefore, in Japan, all art is decorative, and all decorative art is lofty and elegant. That does not, however, apply to the West," unquote. When the concept of fine art and the discipline of aesthetics that addresses fine art were introduced in the late 19th century, numerous Japanese intellectuals were forced to theorize the traditional Japanese artistic practice rooted in daily life. At this time, they focused on the term Geido. This term was coined by Zeami, one of the great Nō actors and writers in 15th century. However, it was precisely through confronting fine art of Western origin that the theory of Geido was systematized, namely in the early 20th century. Okakura and the aforementioned Onishi played a significant role in systemizing that theory. In the following part, at the risk of simplification, I will describe the characteristic of Geido in contrast to fine art. First, as already noted at the end of section 2, although each way marks a specialized area, a person who is familiar with a particular way is regarded as being familiar with the rest of the ways as well. This is because although the specific knowledge and skills involved in each specialized area or way may differ, there is a common attitude involved in the pursuit of each way. In other words, the underlying attitude of training to master the knowledge and skills is common for all the ways. Due to its universality, Geido includes a variety of activities. In the West, fine art is distinguished from the varied other arts by the criteria of being purely focused on beauty and detached from usefulness. In contrast, the criteria of distinguished wide-ranging Geido from other arts is explained by Onishi as follows, quote, "Over time and with cultural development, we find an increasing tendency to subsume all arts that require practice and exercise in all senses, namely mental and physical, regardless of their properties and contents, under the concept of Geido. Thus, it has become increasingly difficult to differentiate the so-called fine art from other arts, such as martial arts, games, and plays. This is because people increasingly became focused on Do a common factor that conceptually unified these various arts, paying little attention to the essence and content of each art, such as beauty, martialness, and playfulness, unquote. In general, the modern Western concept of art excludes non-autonomous arts, for example, decorative applied art. The concept of Gedo, on the contrary, tends to include all arts, provided that they involve physical mental training, such as judo or kido, namely Japanese chess. Here, quote, "The door in the door of training has ethical implication that is generally applied to the life of human beings," unquote, so that art as Gedo becomes deeply rooted in life. Second, Gedo is related to the process in Okakura's sense. This process is not limited to the process followed by an individual who practices to master a certain technique. Rather, it is something practitioners should follow by learning under the guidance of a master and emulating or even surpassing the masters. The Do enables collaborative artistic activities among those who have partake and will partake in the same Do. Thus, Do pertains to the inheritance and transmission of tradition. This leads to an emphasis of the strict rules called kata, literally mold or form, quote, "a kind of spiritual legacy numerous great masters in the past have inherited, cultivated, and refined by participating in the same Do," unquote. Each Gedo follows strict rules, which can be likened to methodos. However, unlike methodos, it does not take one to the end or point of Gedo. Onishi quotes a teaching of Uejima Onitsura, a haiku poet of the Edo period. Quote, "The best way to learn haiku is to imitate the form of your teacher's haiku. Once you have learned it, it is better to leave that form and use the manner that is appropriate to your nature," unquote. Although the rules certainly serve as a prescribed form for the practitioners, they do not restrict their creative flow. Rather, they are preconditions for the practitioner's creativity, because they are trained to let their physical mental self to merge with the rules. This enables them to intrinsically, willingly, and unconsciously live and abide by the rules. However, the creativity is not attributed to the original individuals, as is the case in modern Western aesthetics, but rather to the Do, that is, to use Okakura's expression, the eternal growth which returns upon itself to produce new forms, unquote. The practitioners who have made the rules a second nature through physical mental training will be able to show their skills spontaneously and flexibly, depending on the situation, without being aware of the rules, and realize their own potentials as well as the potentials of the objects they deal with. This is because they concentrate on the present and are involved in the creative process of Do, that is, quote, "their spirit moves in the rhythm of things," unquote. A quote from Okakura. Thus, the goal of Gedo's training is not simply to acquire skills, but to live in accordance with Do. 5. Over the centuries, the modern Western scientific and artistic system has proliferated throughout the world. Under the overwhelming dominance of the West, non-Western academic and artistic systems tend to be regarded as deviations from Western norms. As a result, it has been extremely difficult for non-Westerners to theorize their own academic and artistic systems. This phenomenon is generally referred to as Orientalism. Orientalism is not simply the Westerner's perception of non-Western cultures. Several non-Western intellectuals have internalized Orientalism to modernize or rather westernize their countries. Under these circumstances, Okakura seems to have succeeded in theorizing the non-Western academic and artistic system by refraining from internalizing the Western perspective. Instead, he recognized the dynamic encounter between the Western and Eastern cultures. He reevaluated or reversed the values, thus affirming the significance of the daily life in our world of war and worry and the imperfect. In the face of the oncoming modernization or westernization, Okakura sought, on the one hand, to revive the Taoist idea of the art of being in the world or the art of life, and on the other hand, to relativize Western modernity itself. These difficult attempts by Okakura were made much easier by the development of pragmatist aesthetics over the past 30 years. This is because pragmatist aesthetics, especially the Soma aesthetics that's prefigured in pragmatist aesthetics, provides a framework for promoting dialogue among the academic and artistic regimes of various cultures. Of course, this is not to underestimate the significance of Western academic and artistic regimes. In fact, I myself was educated in the Western style and have engaged primarily in the study of continental aesthetics. I am convinced that this framework also contributes to highlighting the characteristic of continental aesthetics. Simultaneously, this framework also liberates us from exoticism because physical mental training is accessible to all of us and can transform all of us. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Otabe, for this really enlightening lecture that you gave, and comments and questions.
Thank you very much, Professor Otabe. It's wonderful to see you again, and also to be impressed with the depth and comprehensiveness of your research. I love Okakura, and I teach his Book of Tea, and he's a perfect representative of, you can almost say, the aesthetics that's very, very deep in Japanese culture, in all its dimensions, including its packaging. But it's also very important, the translation of Dao or Do in terms of passage, because it relates to also the Taoist metaphysics or the general Chinese metaphysics. I don't know the term in Japanese, but in Chinese it's bien, it's change. Like change is the ultimate reality rather than in the Platonic sense, ultimate reality is fixed. But to go back to Taoism, I mean, and to think about Okakura and Soma aesthetics, so the aesthetic is very strong. The Soma is less strong. And then it brings him back to his interpretation of Taoism in Asia, which he says it's in the direction of aesthetics. In China, Taoism is very much important for Chinese medicine, right? The whole roots of Chinese medicine are based on Taoism, and that's actually the source of Chinese medicine. And why I mention this is also with respect to tea. In China, tea, and also originally in the West, it was also a medical thing, you know? And now, again, I'm speaking from China, the people I know who live their life, and it's also part of the art of living, you know? Nutrition, medicine, health, very big part of some aesthetics. The Chinese people that I know who follow the tea, the cha dao or cha do in Japanese. They drink, for instance, green tea only in the morning because it kind of warms and gets the energy up. The black and red tea they drink for digestion. So I guess the question is, to what extent, apart from like the tea ceremony, which is much more beautiful and formal in Japan, and doesn't exist anymore in China, to what extent is the kind of medical bodily dimension of cha do part of not only Okakura's book of tea, but in the people who practice Gedo today? Because there are people who do practice Gedo, whether it's tea ceremony, flower arrangement, calligraphy, or fencing.
Thank you for your question. So the tea was introduced from China to Japan in 9th and 10th century. At that time, it was a part of medicine that was so precious, so only in the temples people could drink tea as a part of medicine. But in the 14th century, as teaism or cha do prevailed, so it was rather a popular, a sort of popular culture. And the founder of teaism, cha do, or Sen no Rikyu, so transformed such popular culture into a refined culture, so to speak. And therefore, so nowadays, people who do practice Gedo, including cha do, don't think of medicine, but as a mental, physical mental training, it is a part of medicine in a broad sense of the word, I think. And also the Taoism plays totally different roles in Japan as in China. So maybe you know that. So in China, there are many Taoism temples. And so also there are many personified gods of Taoism. But in Japan, so we had few Taoism temples. But the philosophical thinking of Taoism prevailed in Japan. And this aspect, I would like to also underline this aspect of Taoism. Thank you.
Other questions? Comments?
Professor, it was a wonderful lecture, and it was absolutely clear what was the difference between 20 years between the attitude connected to art in Western world and the Eastern world. Can you see differences nowadays when we have in front of different challenges of 21st century, because we are living in the technology-driven world? And we are living in a globalized world. So is there different aspects, different answers on East and Asia side and rest of the world, somehow connected to transhuman movement and so on? How can you see that?
Thank you. So at least in these 30 or 40 years, the culture became globalized. So there is no center of a culture, especially in the field of fine arts. So naturally, New York might be one of the centers, but so each region or each culture can contribute to form the world of art or art world. But art world is not must not be regarded as a singular, but maybe art world is a complex of art worlds in plural. So in this case, in this sense, so East Asian tradition has still some so basis, but it was transformed in the complex context of Atwald's. I think that is my opinion.
Thank you very much.
Yes, Alexander. Thank you very much for your talk. On the page 4, you say that the Tao produce the one produce the two produce three, and three produce all things. It seems to be similar in some sense to the Greek ontology, where first was the chaos, and then from the chaos the cosmos was born. But I suppose that the differences are much bigger than the similarities. So what is your opinion about it? Mm-hmm. So it's a kind of metaphysics or kind of ontology, or what would be what kind of differences we should know here? Mm.
Thank you for your question. So Tao is Tao produces the one. That means this is prior to the one, so tohen, so in so Neoplatonic sense, but so the Tao is in this sense a chaos, but it produces and it is always in change. So Okakura defines this as a great transition. So there is no static state, but he calls it also, this is the eternity. So eternity is the changes. That is the interpretation of Okakura. And so Taoism is, Tao is the metaphysical and also ontological principle. But that cannot be so grasp in a methodological way, so grasp in the if you grasp in the world, so Tao will so diminish.
Yes.
Hello. Thank you for a wonderful presentation, lecture. You touched very briefly in an aside on the influence of some of these ideas on Heidegger and Dasein. Could you expand a little bit on that?
So in my presentation, I refer to only that Heidegger borrow this expression from Okakura's book. But after that, Heidegger met several Japanese scholars in the 30s and also in 40s, and there is a, we can read some dialogue between Heidegger and the Japanese scholar concerning the essence of speech or language. But in Zion's side, Heidegger doesn't mention Okakura's name, so he borrows the expression without mentioning Okakura's book.
We have time, I think, for one last question.
It's a short one. How ethics and aesthetics are related in the way of art? Is it this way of art an aestheticized ethics, or rather an aesthesis, vice versa, yes, an aestheticized aesthetics?
So maybe you can say also aestheticizing of aesthetic, but this is not moralization of ethics. So
of course.
So ethics in the sense of living, so our life ethos, then for Okakura or for the practitioner of Chado, life and art are the same. So therefore, both aestheticization of ethics and aestheticization of the aesthetic, but not moralization.
I think it is time for coffee now. So Professor Otabe, thank you very much for your lecture.
Thank you.